some good team effort with today's webinar. So first thing we're gonna do is a pretest, and that's in the chat. And it's a real simple question. In the chat, I want you to put down which letter most closely answers what you think is the answer to this question, which is what keeps some teachers from using games for learning. So let's see what you got, A, B, C, or D. Okay, ooh. All right. So it looks like, well, pretty spread out, not a whole lot of A's, but a lot of B, C, and D, maybe mostly C and D, okay? So that's helpful. I want you to think about that as we go through, because these are the questions that we hope to answer in today's webinar. Okay, just a couple ground rules. One which is we want you to have fun. So the whole purpose for this webinar is for you so that you can get the information that you know you need. So as Nancy mentioned, we'll be printing out the chat. I'll get a copy of the chat. So anything that you write in the chat, if there's a question you want for later, whatever you write in the chat, Nancy will monitor throughout this webinar, but I'll look at it later and make sure that I follow up with you if follow-up is needed. So join in and be interactive. That's what this is all about. If at any time you want to unmute and ask a question or comment or whatever, go right ahead, okay? And at times, you'll be scoring points for your team. So you're on a team, and we actually will end up with a winning team. And the winning team at the end of this webinar will be recognized in the February issue of the Health Science Educator. So if you've never read a copy of the Health Science Educator, it's a newsletter on the consortium website. And you'll want to go back and print out all the different editions so that you can see what you've missed, okay? So be sure to look at that, because the February issue will be all about games. All right, so since this is a workshop and a webinar about games, we probably should play our first game. So here we go. You'll need a pencil and a paper to write with. And the name of this game is Who Wants to Play a Learning Game? Sound familiar? Here's how we're gonna play. On a blank sheet of paper, you're going to number it from 1 to 10. And then you're going to have about 10 seconds to answer every question. We'll show you the correct response, ask you to give yourself 1 point for each correct answer, and they're all multiple choice. I know that, can you all hear the music? I don't know if you can hear it. You can hear it? Okay. It's annoying, but hey. Get your blood flowing. Okay, so here are 10 questions. Here's your first question. Games are effective tools for teaching leadership, but what percent of a person's leadership ability is genetic? They were born that way. Is it 32%, 44%, 66%, or 78%? You're writing that on the paper in front of you. So write down your answer. What percent is genetic? Turns out it's actually 32%. So according to psychologists, 32% of our leadership ability is genetic, what we were born with, but that means that we can learn 68%. And that's very, very important when we look at games and what games do to help our students develop their leadership skills. Okay, that's question one. Question two, classroom projects are good, but what do games have that classroom projects do not? Rules, defined objectives, measurable goals, or immediate feedback? What do you think? Right, the correct answer is immediate feedback. Games do provide feedback. So like with a lot of classroom projects, I don't know if you remember from college, sometimes taking weeks, months to get back an assignment. The good thing about games is that the results are usually instantaneous. Okay, number three, the teacher guides the learning process. What powerful learning strategy should be employed after every classroom game? Reward and recognition, test of what was learned, reflection, or interleaving? So write down your answer to question three. The correct answer is actually reflection. Reflection, yeah. So reflection, after you play a game, what's beneficial about reflection is that when people talk about what they were thinking and why they were thinking that, it helps us learn the thought process. And so it's actually very instructive. When students hear what other students were thinking, it helps them the next time to develop their thinking skills. So anytime you play a game, a good question is, what were you thinking when we were playing the game? Question 4, scientists are still scrutinizing what aspects of gaming impact what regions of the brain and how. Researchers conclude it's likely that playing video games can contribute to aggression, depression, fine motor skills, or a healthy fantasy life. What do you think? Write down your answer. Actually, the correct answer is fine motor skills. I know a lot of times we are told that video games create aggressive behaviors, but there's not a whole lot of definitive research on that. The research does show, The research does show that video games help students develop their attention ability, their visual and motor skills, with the negative aspect of addiction, which is kind of funny in a way because I can understand why games for fun are addictive, but in health science, the games that we use, the video games, you know, that we're using for our students probably aren't quite so addictive, but they still will get the positive benefits of learning how to pay attention and those types of important employability skills. Number 5, the A Games Project by the University of Michigan in the fall of 2013 studied how teachers actually use digital games in their teaching to support formative assessment. What percent of teachers think games are effective for a variety of purposes? 9%, 18%, 27%, or 36%? What do you think? The correct answer is only 18%, which when you start to look at the value of games and you realize that only 18% of teachers are really embracing the benefits of games, that's it makes sense though, because you know, when we went to college and we learned how to teach, or those of us who learned how to teach the first day we got our job in health science education, but we were never trained how to use games. And if we taught the way we were taught, the way I was taught was not, you know, using games at all. What is also fascinating about this study is that they didn't find any difference in things like gender or age or anything subject area. I thought that was kind of interesting. Question 6, defining games and play is a complicated business, but we know the origins are in your head. What neurological phenomenon is associated with game-based learning? Is it success, memory, understanding, or pleasure? What neurological phenomenon associated with game-based learning? It's actually pleasure. Pleasure is very, very important to human beings. And Psychology Today has a wonderful article that explains how it's a part of our biology, that pleasure drives us to do things. It's a trick that our brain is playing on us to make us do things. In health science education, we play to learn. Number 7, the nationally recognized Manhattan Middle School Quest to Learn uses a game-based approach to teaching and learning in all classes. Students in grades 8 to 10 demonstrate twice the rate of learning growth as college students in science, problem solving, self-awareness, or math. What do you think? Yeah, it's actually problem solving. And if you've never been to the website of the school or if you've never heard about it, it's really fascinating. Basically, all of their classes, rather than have, you know, assignments, they're quests, and everything uses the same game-based strategies that we're going to talk about today. They use that in all their classes. And what they're finding is that these students are excelling in critical thinking, problem solving, analytical skills, and written communication, which in healthcare, those are critical skills. And so if they prove that playing games to learn can develop those skills, then that's something that we as educators need to really take a close look at. Number 8, Trivi is a smartphone app that companies use for social networking, training, stress reduction, communication. What do you think? correct answer is trivia. So what's interesting about Trivy is that the Trivy software uses the same type of cognitive learning, the research about learning that that we know to be very important as part of game development. So basically Trivy is a software program that companies pay a lot of money for to train their employees, and it's all using game-based strategy. In fact, they part of their website is showing you how they use all this research. And for those of you who were involved in the curriculum conference this past October, the workshop that I did on changing their brains used that same research. So for the last 30 years or so, a lot of cognitive scientists have come up with a lot of information and research about how the brain learns. And now we're finding that companies like Trivy are using that same research to make their products. Very important. Number 9, Dan Schwartz is a professor of education and director of the AAA lab at Stanford University. And he says games allow us to measure learning in ways we couldn't do before. He says knowledge is not the outcome we want. We want students to learn how to make choices, enjoy learning, keep trying, or ask for help. So what is the outcome that we really want students to get from our class? He says it's making choices, which I remember a college professor one time telling me that that the person that we should look up to is not the person who's the best orator, but the person who can make the best decisions. So I don't know how true that is, but playing games is a way to help our students develop their non-cognitive skills. Another interesting part about that was that they found that one of the best predictors of a lack of success were people who walk away, or when they fail, they just give up. And hopefully games, through using games in the classroom, we can help our students learn, if you fail, how do I figure out what happened and do it better the next time. So another very important thing. And number 10, I like video games, but they're really violent. I'd like to play a video game where you help the people who were shot in the other games. It would be called Really Busy Hot. That's a comedian. Okay, but the next one, this quote is not a joke. Who said, play is the highest form of research? Was it Louis Pasteur, Betsy DeVos, Mr. Rogers, or Albert Einstein? What do you think? Who said play is the highest form of research? Albert Einstein. In fact, Albert Einstein also said something else very important. He said, you have to learn the rules of the game and then you have to play better than anyone else. And the reason that jumped out at me is because all the years I was involved with HOSA, that to me was the secret to success in HOSA competitive events. Know the rules of the game, follow the guidelines, and then do it better than anybody else. So I agree with Albert Einstein. I'm sure he'd be glad to know that. Okay, so the winner is, out of your score, please. The most you could get is a 10. And go away, music. if you scored a perfect 10, write your team number in the chat and press enter. So don't write your score. Instead, if you scored a 10, write your team number, because then that way we'll know which team won. Did anybody get a perfect 10? Not seeing anything else pop up. How about a 9? If you got a 9, write your team number. How do we know our team number? From the earlier screen, if you came in late, you didn't see your team assignment. So I probably should, exit where I am now and go back to that screen really quick. I am not a Zoom expert like you all, but I'm going to try it, okay? So I'm going to, does that seem like the right thing to do? Because a lot of people came in later. All right, I'm going to stop the share. I'm going to go back to my PowerPoint, get that slide. Then I'm going to try to share it. There's the slide. Okay, there it is. Do y'all see that?
We see it.
Hey, Laura. I just saw Laura. So that's your team. And like I said, originally I got all of the pre-registrations and sat there and counted so that all eight teams would have an equal number of people, because that's what teachers do, right? They prepare ahead of time. And but because of the snow and ice, some of your teams may be smaller than others, and I apologize for that. Okay, I'm gonna go back now to where I was, maybe. We'll see. Does it look like, let's see, let me try this one more time. Okay, now, oh wait, I have to do, get my chat back. Oh, my chat went away. I should have known not to try that. All right, let me try this again. I'm going to go back to where I was and try to get my chat back. And I know.
Okay, we aren't seeing your screen yet, Kim.
Okay, maybe that's what I've done. All right, let me go back in here. Okay. So let's do share screen. Let's do that one and hit share. Thank you for letting me know. Do you see it now?
We see it.
Okay. Then let's, okay, I am, it says I'm screen sharing. And I still can't get my chat to work. Let me do one more thing here and then we'll, I'll bet you those of you who've been teaching virtually, you've never had this happen, have you? I'm kidding. Okay. I can't get it to, let me try this. Okay, one more time. Let's see. Okay, so can you see my screen? Everybody can see my screen. Okay.
We see you. Right.
And I can't see the chat. So Nancy, I'm just going to have to depend on you to tell me what, because I can't figure out why my chat's not showing up. Okay, but we're gonna continue. All right, so the last I saw, it looked like team eight, somebody had a 9. So did anyone besides from another team have 9 or higher?
I'm not seeing anything.
Okay, so then team eight was the winner of Who Wants to Play a Learning Game. Awesome. Okay, we're going to continue and push forward now. So that type of game involves recalling, just a lot of decision making, let's put it that way. So what I want you to do now is in your chat, recall one fact from the game and write it in the chat, something you learned. So think back on that game. What did you learn? Write down one thing in your chat. And that's for teams 1 and 2. So only teams 1 and 2, write down one thing you learned from the chat. Are they popping up, Nancy?
No, one thing they learned from the game.
I'm sorry, from the game. Yeah. Yeah.
So in the chat. Problem solving, games reinforce fine motor skills. Albert Einstein talked about fun. Lots of leadership can be taught. Problem solving. Okay, change students' brains.
Okay, good job. All right, so you learn things from watching the game. Team 3, on a scale of 1 to 5, did you enjoy playing the game? Got any team 3 responses?
Not yet.
Team 3 must be.
Yes, there's a yes. Pleasure from games.
Okay. All right, so, and I have one more question on that particular game. What made it team 4? What made it more enjoyable than just reading the content slide? So was playing the game more enjoyable? I mean, I could have just shown you the content slides and said, this is the information. What made it more enjoyable doing it this way?
There's teamwork.
Okay.
I say The visual, a competition.
Okay. Anybody who wants to unmute and speak at any time can, if you have something to say.
They like the fast pace, interactive.
Okay.
And the fact that you gave follow-up to the answers.
Right, so there was immediate feedback, right? Because you knew your answers right away. You also, when you put something in a format like that, because there's familiarity, the music, the who wants to be a millionaire, your students' brains automatically go into it. It's an automatic entry into motivation. So if I just said, here's questions, they might have done it. But all of a sudden, it's like, who wants to be a millionaire? And they're so used to playing along at home that there's a greater likelihood that they want to be engaged. Okay. So that's why using a format like that is helpful. And if you've never used Jeopardy or Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, there are templates galore on the internet that you can put in your own questions and get a lot of attention. Okay, so I want us to understand the difference between playing a game and something being game-based. The entertainment industry certainly understands it because game-based TV shows that use game-based types of theory are everywhere and they're making a lot of money. So in the chat, list one current television show, this is for everybody, one current television show that isn't a traditional game show but uses elements of gaming. Can you think of any? And Nancy, if you can read a couple.
The Voice.
Okay.
Hollywood Game Night.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Any others?
Survivor, Shazam.
I didn't think of Survivor.
Ellen's Game of Games.
Mm-hmm. So there's a lot. And we could probably, if we sat here for 10 minutes, you would think of more and more for sure. I thought of a few. These are the first ones that just popped into my head. But clearly there is a lot of use, a lot of benefit and a lot of popularity to using this game-based theory. So it's funny that the entertainment industry has figured out how to use it. Maybe we need to take a closer look at figuring out how to use it in our classrooms. So what makes an activity a game? This you're gonna write in front of you. Okay, so see how many, I'm gonna show you four things that makes an activity a game, but really quickly on your paper, can you see I'm writing on my imaginary hand? What do you think makes an activity? What makes it a game as opposed to just a worksheet or an activity? What makes it a game? Just write down one or two words. Okay, well, one of the first things you probably said was competition. And competition is really important because it has a biological impact on us. We want to compete. It's just part of who we are. That's why these professional athletes are making more money in a year than I make in a lifetime. And competition isn't just about competing against other people. It's competition with ourselves. You know, when I sit here in the evening and I turn on Jeopardy, I compete against myself. I don't get any money, but I'm still involved and engaged. And engagement happens to be the next one. So when a learner starts something and they don't want to stop before it's done, if you've ever had students disappointed when the bell rings because they were having fun in your class, you know that you've got some really engaged students. So a game has to have engagement for it to be an effective game. And we've already talked about immediate rewards, not just here's your, not just a sticker or something, but the intrinsic rewards. We know, I mean, I play Jeopardy on my television for the intrinsic reward. I just feel great if I get something right. And that's a lot of times what we need to develop with our students is their ability to appreciate the intrinsic reward of the learning that's happening in our classroom. And finally, decision-making. Decision-making skills are very, very important. And when we play games, we have to do a lot of decision-making. A good game is a lot like a good lesson plan. Three elements of good lesson plans: achievement. So if a game needs to have the same objectives that your classroom, that your lesson plans do, there's very rarely a time where you'd want to play a game for no reason. You play a game to help students learn. But motivation, our lesson plan should stress the connection between what they're learning and what they're going to need to know for their future path career. So should our games. And finally, assessment. As teachers, it's not enough that we share information. We need to do something to understand if they got it. So your challenge as a teacher is to combine the two in such a way that learning is fun and games are useful. It's like bringing them together. When should you use learning games? You use it to introduce content and you use it to apply content. Now, I think the content application part is really important. So we're going to do that next. We're going to play a brain game. So again, you're going to need to number your paper from 1 to 10, and you'll have 60 seconds. And of course, this is to see which team won. So team 8 won the first game. So the rest of you get ready. This game is called Clever Combos, and you're going to be presented with 4 terms. And here's an example, a sample, and you have to figure out what term, prefix, or suffix comes before or after. So would anybody like to shout out and guess what they think fits with cord, pressure, cells, and sugar? Anybody want to unmute and guess? Going once. How about?
Blood.
There you go. Blood. So cord, blood, blood pressure, blood cells, blood sugar. Okay, so that's how it plays. So 10 of them are going to show up. You're going to number your paper from 1 to 10 and write down as many as you can. You're only going to have 60 seconds, and then we're going to see who got the most, okay, and what team they're from. You ready? All right, there you go. Got 30 seconds. Okay, your time is up. Your time is up. So stop writing them down, but now you can correct your own paper. Those are the answers. Count how many you got. You don't have to put it in your chat. Not yet. But go ahead and grade your paper. This is like too much work for an afternoon, isn't it? Okay. Are we good to move on? Everybody had time to grade their paper? Okay, if you got all 10, chat your team number. Nancy, did any team number, did anybody team get all 10 right?
No, they said it was hard.
It is hard, and you were under pressure to get it. How about a 9? Did any team get a 9? No? How about an 8? What's your team number?
Team 4 said they got 8.
Team 4 got 8. Good job, Team 4. Okay. All right.
Now, we didn't read the paper. We don't know for sure, but integrity, we're going with it. Okay.
We trust them. If people were going to cheat, they sure, wouldn't wait till they got down to 8. If we had all 10s, I'm just kidding. So what made it a game? Okay, team 5, write in your chat, why was that a game? Why?
They said it was fun.
Okay, so games are fun. That's good. That was fun. What else? Why else was it a game?
Competition.
Yeah, we were competed. Even though it was a worksheet, we made it into a competition. So what we did was we took something that you do in your classroom a lot and made it more fun and into a competition. Anything else?
It was timed. Okay. It was engaging.
Very good. And that's an important question too. And I can't remember if I put that question or not, but sometimes, you know, did you automatically jump in and start doing it? Or did you just throw your hands up and say, I don't, you know, most people, most of the time we're going to try because it's just, that's who we are. So I want to share with you.
Wait a minute. Team four said they were actually team seven. The one that got seven, they got eight right. If you could change that, it was team seven, not team four.
Team seven. Okay. Got it. I changed it. Team seven. Good job. So I wanted to just pause for a minute and let you know why I care about game-based learning. What happened to me that for me makes this so important. I started teaching high school in 1981. And at that time, I knew medical stuff, and that was it. And one of the things that was lucky for me is I got involved in HOSA. And after a year or two, I started to realize, when we do HOSA activities, they work really hard. But when I'm trying to get them to do classroom activities, they're not working as hard. So I started gradually blending in some of the things I was learning with HOSA into the classroom. And what I found is that I could take any subject we were learning. If I made it into some type of a competitive event, I could get kids engaged. I also noticed that with HOSA, some of the students I had that were not necessarily, you know, the super A student enthusiastic would find things with HOSA that they could excel at. And then it's almost like once they excelled with HOSA, then they started doing better in class. So that's when I started learning about game-based learning. Then, so I taught for 9 years and worked at the State Department, North Carolina for 11 years. And I moved to Florida. And when I moved to Florida, I got a part-time job at Disney World at doing youth education programs and teaching students by playing games. So how's that for a tough job, walking around the Magic Kingdom with a group of students playing games? So if you have any questions about history or the Liberty Bell or any of that stuff, I know all the presidents, but I learned and I noticed, wow, you can really learn a lot playing games. Then I really got lucky and I had the opportunity in 2015 and 2016 to work with Disney Institute. They paid me the big bucks to create games for Fortune 500 college interns to play around the park. So that was pretty cool. Don't get to do it anymore because we've had a pandemic, as you all know. But here's my point. It was through HOSA and through Disney and now through research that I've had the opportunity to really see how effective games can be in encouraging learning. And so all the things that we're talking about today that are benefits of games, I think the reason I'm probably really passionate about it is just having had the opportunity to see what a difference it can make. So as a result of those life experiences, I started writing some books and to create tools for teachers, because when I started teaching in 1981, I mean, there was nothing out there. Nobody had ever heard, it was health occupations back then, no one had ever heard of it. So I started creating tools because I knew how long it took me to create. I mean, that games, who wants to learn, that game that you just played, that wants to be a millionaire, probably took me about 6 hours to create. So creating these great tools, it is time consuming. But that's why I created some tools for learning. And the game that you played, the Clever Combos, is actually from Brain Games and Puzzles, Anatomy and Physiology. So a brain game or puzzle, it's its own unique thing. It's a one-page handout. Every brain game is one page. They come print or electronic. They're all scorable. But you can take any of those brain games and puzzles and use them like we did when we played Clever Combos. Brain games and puzzles, there's an anatomy and physiology version and a health science version. The health science version is aligned to the National Healthcare Skills Standards. So when we played Clever Combos, the question I have for you, and this is for team six and seven to answer, is what is the value, or what do you see to be the value of a brain game or puzzle? You know, what good are they, do you think? can you write something in your chat? What do you think, you know, what, how would you use them, or what, where do you see them being valuable? Are you getting anything, Nancy?
Yes, engagement, active learning, thinking differently. Students can learn at the same time. Engages all students' levels and piques their interest. Applying previous learned content.
Okay.
Neurologic connection.
Good. And that's a really important observation, because that particular game was like the kind of, I would do clever combos as review before final exam kind of thing, as opposed to other games that are just applying the content that you're working on at the time. Okay, so good. That was good. How about teammate, on a scale of 1 to 5, how engaged were you in playing that game?
10.
10?
I got a 10 and a 5, a 10, okay. Totally.
So again, I don't know about you, but haven't you ever seen worksheets that students are not interested in? Imagine if you could take your worksheets and just figure out how to make it into a game, what a difference that would make. Now, brain games and puzzles, that's actually a Texas workshop. We were doing learning games, and one of the teachers said, that's a lot of work on my part. Don't you have something I can just hand them? And I was like, well, no, but we could. And that's how Brain Games and Puzzles was born. The first book I wrote was Learning Games, Health Science. And the reason for learning games, again, had to do with my perception of what I learned with HOSA and what I learned my first few years at Disney. And so there are two learning games books, one's for anatomy and physiology and one's for health science. And the difference is the learning games books are, they're lesson plans. It's all activity based. It's all about teamwork and competition. Every game can be adapted to whatever content the teacher's teaching, but it has to do with learning games are more based on performance, whereas brain games are more based on recall. Now, my favorite book is Learning Games Leadership. And that's because when I started teaching, I've already, you know, I was 25 years old. I didn't know, I didn't know anything about behaviors. I just knew how to teach the way that I had learned in nursing school. And I certainly didn't know how to teach teamwork. One of the national skill standards centers around teamwork, and I would have been lost because I didn't have any idea how to teach that. So I wrote Learning Games Leadership. Leslie, my daughter, and I wrote that because we felt that leadership development was important for me in health science education and for her in college athletics. One of the things this book has that none of the other books have is debriefs. Remember in the game that we played, we talked about reflection. There's two things you want to do after you play a game in class. Number one is reflection. What were you thinking? And number two is recall, retrieval. What did you learn? So two separate things, but you get that out of a debrief, and they're both very important. And if you don't take anything else from this workshop, just the next time you do a classroom activity, retrieval and reflection. Physicality. I like when students are not sleeping. When I was at the State Department in North Carolina, sometimes we would go do Southern Region Education Board school evaluations. And there were times where I sat in the back of an English class one time and counted, and 12 out of 20 kids were sleeping, like head down on the desk sleeping. That doesn't work when it comes to learning. So I like the physicality of learning games. I like the flexibility that you can use them in your classroom with your student organization. If you're a coach, they work. I even got to do one of my learning games leadership activities when I was at the Disney Institute with all the mucky mucks there. That was pretty cool. I like it because it's print. Teachers tell us that they like the electronic version, and I get it. For me, though, I like being able to like flip around the pages and write all over them, and learning games leadership is still in print. And this is a new one. I have a new job now, and I'm going to tell you about that in a little bit, but learning games leadership ties and correlates directly into that. And now we're going to play another game. And the name of this game, it has to do with metaphorical thinking. So So we're going to try to see if you've learned anything with this workshop so far by asking you to create a metaphor. So for example, you can kind of read that one. Okay, I don't see any of the faces on the screen laughing. I thought that was pretty funny. Okay, never mind. I guess you have to like bowling, I don't know. So Create a Metaphor is a game in Learning Games Leadership, and you take whatever you want your students to really think about. It can be anything, but you ask them to create a metaphor. So I want you to really think about gaming and playing games in the classroom. So I did it, and I'll show you my metaphor, and then I'm going to give you a minute to make up your own. My metaphor is games are like salt. So why are games like salt? Well, games add flavor to what you're teaching, just like salt adds flavor to food. If you do too much games or not enough, it's bad. Too much games and it'll taste bad, and not enough games and it'll still taste. I mean, if you've ever eaten hospital food, you know what bland is like. Okay, it's essential for survival, right? We've got to have salt. Games and play, if you look at the whole theories of play and why people play, it's for survival. Animals play, everybody play, or kids play, all to learn and to survive. Other uses for salt, we can use salt to melt snow. Games can melt away our fears, because when you get used to playing games, all of a sudden in your classroom, the student that was really introverted and not very confident can really blossom in the presence of playing. And finally, you control how much. So as a classroom teacher, you're going to control how much you use games. I control how much salt I use, which isn't much these days because of my age, but that's another story. Okay, so now you're going to have a chance to create a metaphor. You can create any metaphor you want. You're going to use your blank sheet of paper. You may be asked to share your metaphor. So you don't have to be a great artist, but be prepared to have the courage to share what you've done. And yes, this is a competition and we have a judge and there will be a winner. So basically how it's going to work is you are going to create your metaphor. You're going to have 1 minute. I'm going to play some music, and when the music stops, your time is up. Does anybody have any questions? You know what you're doing. Games are like what? And then you're going to have the opportunity to show your metaphor and share it with the group. You ready? All right, your 1 minute starts now. I thought I'd stop the share and get my chat back, and I stopped the music, but that's okay. You can keep going without music. Okay, your 1 minute is up and I got my chat back so I can see my chat screen, yay. So now it's your turn. And I know you didn't have much time. When you do this with your students in class, you'll give them a lot more time. However, when your team number's called, one member of the team should unmute and share their metaphor in 30 seconds or less, and you can hold it up and let us know what you got, okay? So be brave and let's start with team one. Anybody from team one want to unmute and tell us about their metaphor? Okay, team one, we'll come back to you. Let's try team two. Anybody from team two want to share their metaphor?
I'll try.
Great. Tell us who you are. And
hi, I'm Lori. I'm from Michigan, and I teach at Davison High School.
Okay.
I wrote, games are like popcorn because you can pop into any game you like.
Okay. Good. Anything else? All right. Good job, Team 2. We got an entry from Team 2. Okay, Team 3. Can you beat that? Who have we got? Clara?
I'm Team 7.
I'll try. I'm driving, but I will try. I am Sue Singh from Westminster High School. And I said games are like Thanksgiving feast. The more good food you have, everybody's involved. And if it's not, then people don't want to be there. I just couldn't think of anything else.
Oh, that's good. No, seriously. Excellent. Yeah, it's got Thanksgiving definitely for the food. Good job. And Sue,
you
were okay, and you were team
three?
Okay,
yes.
Great. Team 3. How about team 4? Anybody from team 4 want to jump in? Unmute and tell us your story. I think team 4 might be Texas, and I think they're under ice and snow. How about team 5?
I'll try.
Okay. Cynthia.
Sunshine after a rain.
Okay.
We need the rain, as in the information that we need, but then when the sun shines there, we get to enjoy and have fun and success with that information.
Oh, okay. Very good. You're right. We need the rain. Excellent. Good. Okay. That was team 5, right? How about team 6?
I'll go.
Kimberly. I like your name, by the way.
Thank you. I like yours.
Thank you.
I said that games are like a house because you can use them to build a foundation and walls, but you can also use them to put a roof and a cap on something you've been learning.
Oh, okay. All right. Very good. Excellent. Good job. Kimberly. Do you go by Kimberly or Kim?
I actually go by Kimberly, so Okay. That's the difference.
Good. Well, I'm actually just a Kim.
Okay.
So. Anyway, it's nice to meet you. Okay. Team 7, I think.
Clara?
Is Cynthia Team 7? Who wants to do the Team 7?
Team 7 is in the chat on Debbie.
Okay, Team 7, Debbie.
Oh, I've got Team 7 on the micro.
Okay, so. In the chat, it says Team 7 games are like spices. They add an interesting flavor to the list. Okay, that's good. How about Clara, did you have something you wanted to add?
Oh, okay. I didn't realize anybody else from Team 7 was going, but I said games are like Play-Doh. It's creative, tactile, visual. You can use a variety. It's engaging. It's reinventive. Fun, and you can conform the games to your needs.
Okay. That's a really important point, that you can change the game to fit your needs. So nice metaphor. Okay. How about Team 8?
I'll go. This is Jane Shovlin.
Hey, Jane.
Hi, Kim. I said that games are like a wave in the ocean. There's a rhythm to it. And you can control that rhythm, how fast or how slow, how far in you go in depth into the material. And then when you're reflecting, it's like when the ocean goes back. Each wave can bring something new, like a shell, a dead fish, a shark. And that it can have a calming effect depending on where you play, what level you play in the waves. It can be calming, or it can be more exciting, almost scary or motivating, the deeper you go and the bigger the waves get. So.
Okay, all right. And someone asked what Team Virginia, I think Virginia's Team 8 as well. So good job, Jane, good job. Nancy said you just moved to the beach. Good answer. Okay, did anybody from Team 1 wanna jump in? Okay, then Our judges are going to confer very quickly and let us know who was the winning team. Do we have a winner, Judge? What do you think?
Team 7 with Plato.
Team 7 was the winner. Good job, Team 7. All right, everybody give yourselves a round of applause, but Team 7, you're all champions. They just won this one. Champion metaphor thinker. Good job. Okay, I'm moving ahead. So by now, because of what you heard, so when you play this with your students and you're reinforcing course content, did you notice that when people were doing their metaphors, they were actually sharing knowledge of games and game theory? That's the whole idea behind playing that game, is to really help us understand what games are all about. So very quickly, that NCLEX reference. So I started a new job during this pandemic, writing test items for a company that makes NCLEX practice. And one of the things that we're finding out is that the nursing exam is changing. And when the nursing exam changes, it isn't a career in isolation. Other health professions are looking at what they're doing. So basically, a lot of research was showing that our students are leaving their education with a lot of knowledge, but not an ability to know how to use it. And that's probably true with the students that left my health occupations program, because back then I taught content, I didn't teach decision making. Last month's issue of Health Science Educator, which is on the consortium website, has really good information about what clinical judgment is, and even a game that you can play in class for free that has to do with clinical judgment. And so we are, because of time, we're out of time, so you're not gonna have to take the final exam. but
exempted, can't be exempted exam.
Oh, okay. The exam would have been for you to basically reflect on what you had learned by sharing something in the chat about what you had learned. But instead, because your time is valuable, I just want to say thank you. If you have any questions that didn't get answered, anything else you want to know, please, you can put it in the chat now and I'll get a copy, or you can email me directly. My website is creativeedservices.com. My email is on the website. Nancy Allen has my email if you need it. But just like the consortium's goal is to support you, my goal is to support you. So if there's anything that I can do to be helpful, then please let me know. Otherwise, thank you for your courage and bravery in playing all these games. And I look forward to reading the details in the chat or hearing from you if there's anything that I can do in the future.
Okay, Kim, thank you. I'll leave the chat up for a little while in case people have questions. Remember, if you want a certificate for this to document your professional development, I've put the email address in for requesting that. Also, for future webinars, we have two coming up, one on health informatics and one on medical assisting. And so you're welcome to check those out and join. Join us if you can. Kim, there's a question here about, as we say goodbye, there was a question about how can you buy the Brain Game books? And I'm assuming that would be...
Go to my website.
creativeedservice.com. Yep. And you put it there. Yeah. Okay.
Just go to my website. You can get them on Amazon, but it's actually a lot less expensive on my website. So don't go to Amazon. And if you have any questions on what's there, a lot of good specials. And if you go to the consortium website, read the Health Science Educator newsletter, and you will see a lot of good ideas, and a special discount on Learning Games Leadership is in that book.
Yeah, and I'm putting that website, for the newsletters, it's just healthscienceconsortium.org and then /newsletters. Okay. And I put that in the chat too.
Yep.
Okay. So Kim, I'll send you a copy of this chat. And also this has been recorded. And so this will be posted on our website.